May the Lord be with you. We gather this morning in the name of Jesus Christ. We gather together, and I was leaning over and looking. I'm so glad we're back into the flow of the school year for one important reason. I see some of your faces again. I know this summer has called a lot of us out traveling and doing all sorts of stuff, but I welcome you in Jesus' name back among God's people. We're called here by Jesus. He brings us here. He, through his Spirit, brings us into this place for an encounter, to hear the word proclaimed, to confess together our sin, and to hear words of assurance that we are indeed children of God, forgiven and restored. And so I am eager today to encounter with you what God is going to do. God is doing a lot of stuff among us, and I have some announcement I'd like to make. On behalf of Maggie Herndon, I want to let y'all know, in case you didn't receive the email, the church council is going to gather on August 22nd. Check your spam folder if you are on church council to make sure that you got that notice. I noticed in the bulletin that our Explorers Bible study is back on Thursdays, or will be back on the 25th. For those of you who are looking for something to do on Thursday mornings, or if you really want an in-depth study of God's Word, that is an amazing Bible study. And so I encourage y'all, it's not technically something that CrossGates is doing. We are inviting the explorers to come in and do that. But for those of you who have been a part of that, I'm sure you can attest to how meaningful that time is. But Thursdays, so keep an eye out in the bulletin. And one other announcement. Yesterday, I texted Maggie and Faith because on CBS, they were hosting a pickleball tournament. And Maggie, if we ever get to that point where we're playing like those ladies were playing, I don't want to have anything to do with it. I don't want to have anything to do with that. But Wednesdays at 10:30, every Wednesday, we gather in the CAC and we play pickleball, we play all sorts of other games, things like that, and then we all go to lunch together. I'm not sure what we're calling that, the lunch bunch, but if y'all would like to come and simply be a part of that, it's a lot of fun and enjoyable, and I usually only fall about once or twice per game. And so if you want to come see your pastor roll around on the ground in anguish as his ankle is doing things it shouldn't, at least come for that. Kim, we have somebody here in the sanctuary, or actually two people, that I would like for you to introduce to the church and officially welcome them into your music ministry.
I'm very excited this morning to introduce you to Mrs. Naomi Bates, our new pianist accompanist, and her husband, Daryl. Naomi was born and raised in Clinton, Mississippi, graduated from Clinton High School, and next week, Daryl and Naomi will have been married for 41 years. And they got married and lived a short time in Texas, and then they lived in Philadelphia, Mississippi, and in 2017, they moved to Brandon. And Naomi comes highly recommended. She played for the Attaché Show Choir over in Clinton. She's played for Mississippi College. She's played at a myriad of churches in her life, starting at a very early age. And she taught IT courses for 23 years?
I played for Northwest Rankin.
Northwest Rankin Show Choir as well. Yes, she's taught with Amanda Harris for many years, and so we really welcome her and her beautiful musicianship to CrossGates. All right, so let us begin our worship. If you would stand with me and join in the responsive psalm reading as it's found in your bulletin. Give ear, O shepherd of Israel, you who lead Joseph like a flock. You who are enthroned upon the cherubim, shine forth in the presence of Ephraim and Benjamin and Manasseh. Stir up your might and come to save us. You bought a vine out of Egypt. You drove out the nations and planted it. You cleared the ground for it. It took deep root and filled the land. The mountains were covered with its shade, the mighty cedars with its branches. Why then have you broken down its walls so that all who pass along the way pluck its fruit. Turn again, O God of hosts. Look down from heaven and see. They have burned it with fire. They have cut it down. May they perish at the rebuke of your countenance. Then we will never turn back from you. Give us life, and we will call on your name. Our opening hymn is How Firm a Foundation. Let's sing together.
Testament reading today is from Isaiah 5, 1 through 7. Let me sing for my beloved, my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved has a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it and hewed out the wine vat in it. He expected it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done in it? When I expected it to yield grapes, why did it not yield grapes? And now I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste. It shall not be pruned or hoed, and it shall be overgrown with berries and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it. For this vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his pleasant planting. He expected justice, but saw bloodshed, righteousness, but heard a cry. The New Testament reading is in Hebrews 11:29-12. By faith, people passed through the Red Sea as if it was dry land, but when the Egyptians attempted to do so, they were drowned. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell after they had been encircled for 7 days. By faith, Rahab the prostitute did not perish with those who were disobedient because she had received the spies in peace. And what more should I say? For time would fail me to tell of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, Jephthah, of David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, obtained promises, shut the mouths of lions, quenched raging fires, escaped the edge of the sword, won strength out of weakness, became mighty in war, put foreign armies to fight. Women received their dead by resurrection. Others were tortured, refusing to accept release in order to obtain a better resurrection. Others suffered mocking and floggings and even chains and imprisonment. They were stoned to death. They were sawn in two. They were killed by the sword. They went about in the skins of sheep and goats, destitute, persecuted, and tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered into the deserts and mountains and caves and holes in the ground. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witness, let us also lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the sake of the joy that was set before him endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God.
This is the word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to
God. You did great. Even Jephthah. Jephthah's a hard one. We want to do something special here at Cross Gates, and I know other churches do this as well, and we call it the blessing of the backpacks, but it's really a time at the beginning of a school year to acknowledge, to pause, and to bless and pray for anybody who's involved in school. So that it doesn't matter what age you are. If you are back in school, if you teach in school, if you serve in school, if you homeschool, all of that. We're beginning that new year of earnest learning. And so we would like to invite all of you who fit that bill of being someone who is educating, working, serving, to join me and Jordan down here. And if you don't come, I will start calling your names out. But I see some children who already have their backpacks on. But if y'all would like to come down here with us and stand down here, I see some other parents, y'all come down here. And Julie, I am going to call you out because I know that you're one of those people who are not going to come. But Julie, yes, you too. See, we got some grown-ups coming, thank you. We have some backpack tags that we would like for y'all to come and get. Tell you what, you're a grown-up. Would you help pass some of these out to these kids? You can grab one. Go ahead and grab one. What we have on these backpack tags, would you help me pass some of those out? So Cross Gates, do you see who's here? No, you gotta come back. Nope, you gotta come back. You can't leave. You can't leave. Cross Gates, what we see before us is the future. What we see before us are people whom God loves and whom God has gifted with a gift of teaching and with students who are eager to learn. I remember when I was this age of wondering, how am I ever going to use this? You remember that? I think it's a good question when you're in class. Teacher, how am I ever going to use this? I want y'all to know, kids, students, that I have learned to use everything that my teachers have taught me, even the weird geometry stuff, which I still have nightmares over, okay? Jordan, you represent our teachers. And I would like for you as a representative of our children's ministry, but also as someone who's gone back into the teaching classroom, if you would like to say something to the church and to the teachers and the educators and everyone else.
So like Trey mentioned, I've come back into the classroom after taking 2 years off. So I'm in a third grade classroom this year, and boy, teaching's hard. So I want everybody to look at the back of their tags, if it's not already on your backpack. It says, let all that you do be done in love, 1 Corinthians 16:14. And I just challenge you all to remember that as you go into your new years. We have so many people in schools that make school work. It's not just the teachers, it's not just the students. It's the people in the front office that do all of the paperwork that we could not get done without. It's the people, the principals, the custodians, the cafeteria workers, the interventionists, the PE coaches, the music teachers, the art teachers. There's so many pieces and moving parts of a school. So I just challenge you to be kind and treat with love when you encounter anybody at a school. And for those of us who don't go to school every day, I just challenge you to pray for every single one of those moving parts, that they might have a good year as well. The next thing that I want to challenge you to do is try to stay positive. We had to start off our Sunday school this morning with some positive affirmations because we were already mumbling and grumbling about our first week of school. So we needed to turn it on our head and make some positive statements that we go into next week, you know, with a good mindset. So I just pray and challenge you to keep positive, even though it's really easy to be annoyed that you have to wake up early, or you don't want to do your homework, or oh, there's a test on Friday. Try to walk away with each week with a couple of positives. That way you can, then in returns, you know, positive mindset leads to kindness to others. So.
Thank you. You're absolutely right. And I think that's a lesson for all of us, Jordan. On your tag, there are interesting, some profound words on here. The first one is grace and peace. That we tend to use these words like, what does that mean? That one of the earliest greetings in the church, one of the earliest blessings in the church, was simply to go to someone and say, grace and peace to you. As a reminder that God is with you, that God has called you, and God will not forsake you. There's a verse on the back that Sherry and Jordan included for you to carry with you this year. Let all that you do be done in love. 1 Corinthians 16:14. That is our hope, our wish, and our prayer for all of you, from administrators, teachers, anyone in the classroom, to students, anyone who's serving. Let all that you do be done in love, not a sappy, saccharine love, a disciplined, holy, good love that places the interest of others ahead of your own. And so I'm going to have a prayer after I read something for y'all, but I want y'all to join me in something I found. Bishop Swanson posted this a couple days ago, and it's a back-to-school blessing by the Reverend Marilyn Thornton, and I would like for y'all to repeat it to me. Can y'all do that? Especially y'all here. Okay. Bless my paper and my pen. Guide my spirit deep within. Help me think and help me play. This whole school year, day by day. As I move from class to class, guide my footsteps, clear my path. Keep my tongue to speak your words. Let your will for me be heard. In every subject, high or low, may God's excellence be shown. Keep me strong to reach the prize. To grow in grace, becoming wise. Help my family be a part. As I lift my mind and heart. As I study, work, and pray. Be with them throughout the day. Let's pray together. Oh God, those who stand before us are those we love. For all these students and teachers and educators, we ask for your special blessing. We ask that your Holy Spirit would come to them, empower them and gift them and call them back to you. May this church surround them with your love, with your peace, with your grace. So God, as we enter this school year, we know it's going to be a long journey, and we commit to go all along the way with them. Fill them with love, fill them with strength and mercy and wisdom and intelligence. It's in the name of Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. Okay. Children, if you want to go to Children's Church, Jordan is going to walk you over to Children's Church. The rest of you, you may go ahead and be seated. We have a few extra name tags for those of you who you're not sure whether you count or not. You can come and get one and put it on your keychain, put it on your briefcase, put it somewhere. I'm going to take some to my wife to make sure she carries one on her backpack. Go ahead. Absolutely. It is good to gather around the altar to pray, a holy place, a sacred place where we come and acknowledge that we need to encounter God. In that encounter, we find ourselves asking God, am I who I need to be? Have I been the kind of person, have I prayed the way I ought pray? Have I served the way that I ought to serve? And it causes in us a sense of, have I? I wonder, should I? What do I do now with that? Well, here at Crossgates, we pause. We pause in the worship of God to make a prayer of confession, to join with God, to join with one another, to speak the truth about the way things are, so that we can hear a deeper truth of God's love for us. I invite you to join me now praying together our prayer of confession. God who loves in raining fire, we, like the people of ancient Judah, are lost. You have planted in us fertile soil, but we have produced rotten fruit. We don't cultivate and care for one another. We have squandered every good thing you have given us. We have grown apathetic in our service to you. We are a broken people. Please kindle in us the fire of your Holy Spirit. Please give us the motivation we need to do our best for you and your people. Please forgive us for letting the detritus of our lives build up so that we cannot see your light. So hear the good news, Crossgates. Everything that we've said is true. And in the profession of that truth, and the proclamation of that truth, we hear something deeper in our hearts. That if you but confess to me, I am faithful and just to forgive you of your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. So because we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, we can lay aside our sins. Let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the perfecter of our faith. Jesus endured the cross for us. He has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Thanks be to God. As this forgiven people, as this reconciled people, as the people who have heard the good news, we come and make offering. We've come here to praise God and to lift high our songs to God. But we've also come here, all of us, with conditions in our lives, in our hearts, where we want to say to God, help us, please. And there are those of us who have an earnest desire in our hearts to pray for other people. And so I invite y'all to hold within your hearts this morning and in our prayers, Joreen and Don Williams and Meredith Smith, again, who is undergoing treatment for leukemia. For all of those others that are on our prayer gate, prayer page, and for all the concerns that you hold in your hearts, for the students, for the new school year, for the brokenness that still creeps in. We can nonetheless come to God and make that as our first offering. Hey, God, can you do something with this? Can you do something with my prayers? Can you do something with my money? Can you do something with my heart, my hands? Can you do something? Because I want to be a part of what you're doing. So that's why we start with our first offering of our hearts and our prayers. So let's once again join together in prayer. Oh God, our hearts are laid bare before you. With deep joy of seeing all these children and educational professionals gathered here, for their desire to serve you and serve others. Oh God, we truly, deeply know that education is critical. Critical to your kingdom, critical to our nation, critical to the flourishing of every human life. So God, may we, your people, recommit ourselves to the support of education in our own lives and in the lives of those around us. May we be a people who continue to learn, lifelong engaging in that which is beautiful and good in this world, and especially the witness of your scripture. So God, please receive our praise as an offering. Please receive our confessions as offerings. Please receive our hearts, the words of our lips, the praise that comes from them. Oh God, we know that you see us as beloved children. So in light of that, in the goodness of your love, we pray the prayer that your Son, Jesus, taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As a people eager to make offering, I invite you now to make offering. We have boxes around the perimeter of the sanctuary. If you have a financial gift that you'd like to make, to renew that commitment to be a financial disciple, someone who gives that way. But we also first ask, before you do that, to turn to someone, to stand up and find someone and go to them and say, may the peace of Christ be with you. And let your response be, and also with you. That is the offering that Jesus taught us to make before we do anything with our money. Come on, Cross Gates, let's go do that real quick.
Thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Thank you.
your spirit, that as the scripture is read and your word proclaimed, we may be transformed. Amen.
Let's remain standing now as we hear the gospel read this morning. Our gospel reading is from Luke chapter 12, and this comes from a chapter in which Jesus has turned his face toward Jerusalem, and he sees a fire coming, the fire of judgment, a fire of burning, but also something else, a fire of Holy Spirit. So let's hear what he had to say. I came to bring fire to the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled. I have a baptism with which to be baptized, and what stress I am under until it is completed. Do you think that I have come to bring peace to the earth? No, I tell you, division is coming. From now on, five in one household will be divided, three against two, two against three. They will be divided. Father against son, and son against father, mother against daughter, and daughter against mother, mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, and daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. He also said to the crowds, when you see a cloud rising in the west, you immediately say, I think it's going to rain. And so it happens. And when you see the south wind blowing, you say, there will be a scorching heat soon. And it happens. You hypocrites, you know how to interpret the appearance of the earth and the sky, but why do you not know how to interpret the present time? This is the word of God for us, the people of God. You may be seated. Amen. Thank you, choir. It's good to have you back up here playing backup. Super, super beautiful song this morning. Now, Cross Gates, I know that anytime you see a theme or hear a theme of fire, you're already thinking, Trey, what have you burned down? What have you done in your backyard? And I want you to know that the burn pile is now about 12 feet tall, and it's getting taller. And don't worry, I'll wait until it's cold before I light it. There will be video documentation, and I will call to make sure my life insurance is fully up to date before I do that. But today is not a confession of my pyromania. Instead, it's about something else. You know, Kim, when she and I sat down and reviewed the text and were looking at it, she basically said, there's no better topic that a pyromaniac preacher could preach than one of Holy Spirit and fire. And so I would agree with you. But what happens when you've waited too long for a good fire? Missy and I, of course, you know, traveled out to New Mexico, out west. Earlier this year, back in April, I started watching the news. And I saw that these beautiful places where I had visited so often as a child and had visited last year, where I, in fact, the place where I interred my parents' remains in the Pecos River, were being run over by a massive fire. It's called the Hermit Peak and the Calf Wilderness Fire. And it grew and grew and grew until it became the largest fire in New Mexico history. And I would watch it. I found an app on my phone, and I could literally see where they were positioning people trying to get this fire to go out. Regrettably, this fire, one of them, was started by national forestry workers who were trying to clear the underbrush to prevent a bad fire from happening. What they didn't know is that the week after they started this brush fire, that the humidity was going to drop to basically zero, the temperature in April was going to rise to over 100 degrees, and a south wind was going to start to blow at over 40 miles an hour. And within just a few days, that fire had reached 534 square miles. Ended up just burning everything, raging. They couldn't stop it. There was nothing they could do. So to put this in perspective of how big is 534 square miles, Brandon is 25.75 square miles. Rankin County is 806 square miles. So basically, about two-thirds of Rankin County was blistered, completely charred. And what had happened, though, what happened to that area is something that we can learn about and how it applies in our spiritual lives. That if we wait too long for a good fire, then the weeds grow, the bramble grows, and that stuff builds up. And it builds up some more. And then the hot winds come in, dry it out, and all it takes is a lightning strike, a campfire, or even a forestry worker, and that thing is out of control. Jesus was lamenting about how long they had waited for a good fire. In Luke chapter 12, verse 49 and 51, that's really what he's talking about. I came to bring fire to the earth. And oh, how I wish it was already kindled. Jesus was brokenhearted that the fire that he came to bring, the Holy Spirit, the presence of God, hasn't already been burning except inside of him. For generations, the weeds had grown up. The bramble had grown up in the community life and in the hearts of people. They hadn't remained on fire. They hadn't remained cleaned. And Jesus was there saying, oh, how I wish the fire of God's presence in your life had already been burning, because I know what's about to happen. I know what God is about to do. He's going to bring fire. In verses 52 and 53 that we read here, what we see is that the people had quenched the fire of God's presence for too long. And these weeds of sin and rebellion were tall and they were dry. Parents and families were going to be broken and divided. The fire was going to rage because so many people split, 2 to 3 out of 5. We're going to see this fire burning, and some are going to say, please, Lord, burn me clean. And others are going to say, how is this happening? Why is this happening? This is bad that's happening. The crowds, he looks around at them. Jesus says there in verse 54, too many are acting surprised that God's fire will burn hot in order to clean sin. Too many people had forgotten how God's love is poured out. Too many people had forgotten how God's justice and judgment is mingled together with love and says, I will keep you clean. We heard Isaiah talk about this. Jordan read out of Isaiah, and then in the psalmist we heard about a hedge, a vineyard, and how important it is to keep it trimmed, to keep it clean, and keep the wall up around it, to make sure it's in the right conditions, to make sure it produces the right fruit. But they weren't taking care of the vine, God's beloved vine. They weren't caring for it. And the walls were torn down, and the vines dried out, and it was producing the wrong kind of fruit. Jesus is joining in a line of prophets who say, too many of you are surprised that God's fire will burn hot when God is cleaning sin. And yet you can look around in nature, and you know what happens. Y'all can look to the horizon. We can tell this. I mean, I'm glad we have these apps and we have our favorite weather person, but we just go outside and look at the horizon, and for the most part, we can tell, yep, it's gonna rain. I got a flag in my backyard. I'll look outside the window every morning and see which direction it's blowing. And if it's blowing from the south, I know it's gonna be hot. If it's blowing from the north, I know it's gonna be dry. Jesus is saying, you can see the signs all around you. How is it that you've lost sight of knowing that that's how God works too? That when we live our lives forgetting to stay in the cleaning fire of God, that if we walk away from that and the stuff builds up, and it gets dry because we haven't been in God's blessing. That these beautiful life, these flowers that God wants to bring into our lives, this garden, we stop tending it, we stop watering it, we stop cleaning it, and after a while it becomes a pile of hot brush. And Jesus is saying, you can see in nature what happens. Why can't you see in your own life? And he calls us hypocrites for that. Because we act surprised. That God's fire ignites to keep us clean, to keep the forest floor from getting overgrown. But what happens when we wait too long for a good fire? So what about us now? I know this isn't talking about all of us. I know I'm literally preaching to the choir and preaching to the church that's here. And Cross Gates at home. I know that you're here because you want God to continue to keep your forest floor clean. I know that you're here to keep your vineyard good. So let me offer Hebrews as the word of encouragement to us, to those who are in the fire right now. That's the perspective I invite you to take. You're in the fire. You're continually being cleaned by it. You're continually in the presence of God's Holy Spirit poured out over you, washing you clean and keeping things burned back that would otherwise put you in danger. The writer of Hebrews says in chapter 11, verse 29, about how by faith all these people did what they did. We call it the roll call of the faithful. By faith, people passed through the Red Sea. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell. By faith, Rahab the prostitute welcomed spies in and protected them. By faith, all these other people, Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, the prophets, all through faith, did what they did. And not just them, us. Not just them, us. Ordinary people who by faith continued. For those women who had lost their loved ones, yet saw God do something amazing. For those who were tortured, who refused to be released from jail. For those who were mocked and flogged and kept in chains, who were stoned, who were tortured. For those who had to cover themselves in weird sheepskins and hide from the people who were intending to do their harm. By faith, all these people remained there in what God was doing in the fire. They stayed there. And what I hear and hear for us is you are not alone. So many before us have remained faithful even as the fire burned around them. There they were in it. And the writer of Hebrews says that the world was not worthy of those people because of their faith. How they stayed with God and said, God, I know you're here. It hurts. I'm being burned. Help me. And God indeed was there with them. But something amazing is here that I want to reread and emphasize again for us. In fact, if you got your Bible, highlight it, flag it, put a star on it. Hebrews chapter 11, verses 39 and 40. Yet all of these people, all the ones I just talked about, all the ones we read about, all those who suffered, all those who led, all those who won in battle by faith, all of these, though they were commended for their faith, did not receive what they were promised. Since God had provided something better, so that they would not, apart from us, be made complete. In that fire that burns, something else is happening. It isn't just that God is there, it's that God is doing something in all of us. When the Holy Spirit is lit in us, we burn together. It's better that way, the writer of Hebrews says. It's better that way. And the reason why is simply this. Where is the safest place to be when there's a wildfire? Where is the safest place to go if you're in a wildfire? Do you run out ahead of it? Do you run away from it? No. Where is the safest place to be when the wind is pushing the fire? You go where it's already been burned. You go into the area where the fire has already raged. The writer of Hebrews in our gospel proclaims to us this: where was the fire of God's judgment and God's love burning the hottest ever? At the cross. Where was God's greatest work that God was doing and saying, I am going to make the world clean. I'm going to preserve it. I'm going to protect it. And the way to do that is to confront the evil, the darkness, the crud, the sin, the overgrowth. And they're going to try to set it on fire and burn it. No, I'm going to use that to cleanse them. Holy Spirit poured out on them, on us, and we burn together with this fire of God. And we know that we're safe now, where God has already burned hottest. So we turn then to that wonderful little passage there in verse 12. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let's lay aside everything that gets in the way. All the bramble, all the dry stuff, all the stuff that should have been hauled off. Let's get it out of the way. The writer of Hebrews says that we are the plume of smoke. We are the evidence that God is working. So keep an eye on Jesus, he says. Look to Jesus, the pioneer, the perfecter. the one who showed us the way, the one who had joy in the face of what Jesus said here. I have a baptism in which I have to be baptized, and I am under a lot of stress until that happens because I'm here to set the world on fire. And oh, I wish God's fire had already been burning here. The writer of Hebrews says that we are all called up together, every single person in here, and all the saints throughout time, all of them, though they were commended for their faith, did not receive what was promised, since God had provided something better so that they would not, apart from us, be made perfect. The thing that God created that is better than any one of them receiving a blessing of their faith, the thing that God said was better, was us. God said what's better is that we all do it together, that we're all in it together by faith. Every single one of us can peer through the future, can peer into the past and say, I see it, I understand, I'm part of something that God is doing, and it sets me on fire. So we're surrounded in this great plume of smoke of God's fire burning. And we look around and we say, oh, it's not just me, it's you. We're together giving evidence of God's work in the world. We're the plume of smoke. We're the evidence that God is at work. So let's keep our eyes on Jesus, our raging fire, the one who comes to set the world on fire, to bring it light, to clean it, to keep it clean. So CrossGates, my hope for us today is that we won't wait too long for a good fire, that we won't continue to do the old pattern of getting clean and then forgetting the discipline, of acting like it's all good now until we look around and we see the fire coming, and we know there's a lot of fuel that needs to be burned. My invitation to all of us is that we enter this new school year to re-engage with one another, to re-engage in the disciplines of our faith, to pray, to be disciplined in your prayer, to read scripture, to find a group of people to study with. Start your own little group of people. Come to the Explorers Bible Study. Get involved with a Sunday school class. Pray, read your scripture, and find some people to hold you accountable in your faith, and you be someone to hold someone accountable. Not in judgment, but sit down and say, help me see where the weeds and junk have grown up. I need to be burned clean. I'm not going to wait too long for a good fire. So CrossGates, every time we hear the word of God proclaimed, we respond. We want to know how we can be a part of what God's doing. I invite us to renew our commitment to one another, to God, and to invite fire into our lives, and to recognize that smoke billowing out of every one of us as the evidence that God is doing something amazing in all of us and through all of us, because for whatever reason, God provided something better that all of us will be a part of and be made perfect through. Amen. Our hymn of response is Shine, Jesus, Shine. It's an old chorus I remember singing in college days. Kim and I felt that it would be appropriate to sing this song. I invite us now to stand and sing our response, Shine, Jesus, Shine.
Thank you.
Coscates, what's interesting about that trip that we took was that that fire had indeed burned everywhere, and we could see evidence of it. And I went there expecting to be sad, to see nothing but black charcoal everywhere. And instead, what I saw was something amazing. What I saw was that the monsoon rains had begun to return finally after a year and a half of drought. And the trees that did survive were still there. And the area that was completely burned clean had already begun to spring forth in life. And there were flowers everywhere. See, the fire of the Holy Spirit that burns, its purpose is to clean us so that we can produce that which God wants in us, to be the light of the world, to show the love of God, and together, all of us, to be a representative of a deeper truth that what God wants to accomplish in the world, God wants us all to be a part of. So go now in the light and love and fire of God's Holy Spirit at work in you. Come on, let's go.